We are back, Sam Seder, on the Majority Report. I continue with my coverage from the Mass Torts Conference in Las Vegas, Nevada, here in the Bellagio. And joining me now is Caleb Cunningham. He is from Levin Papantonio Rafferty. And Caleb, you're handling cases of exploited teens. Is that, can you tell me more specifically about the nature of these cases?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, there's a shadow industry in this country of about $25 billion in public funds that incarcerates between 150 and 200,000 kids in America every year. Now, some of this is public funds, but they also get private funds. We were very excited at this conference to have Paris Hilton, who is a survivor of four different programs in the exploited teen industry, where she was sexually assaulted, forced to do manual labor and some other terrible things, solitary confinement, chemical and physical restraints. And unfortunately, this is happening all over the country. And with Mike Papantonio and my firm, Levin Papantonio Rafferty, we're attacking this industry.
So, walk us through this. These are like, I'm aware of kids maybe in high school, or I've heard stories. Give me a sense of like what these facilities are and why are they all like, how do you sue them all together?
So they can't be sued all together. They're too different, and they categorize themselves differently. Some call themselves wilderness treats. Some of them call themselves gay conversion camps. There's lots of different buckets that these can fall in. But what we see across the industry is lack of regulation, sexual abuse, and physical abuse. And what we've seen in the last 10 years in particular is we've seen Wall Street money infiltrating these companies and doing what the state used to do, cutting staffing, cutting these things, and having grossly unqualified people at these facilities because now it's for profit. A lot of this was born out of the idea that the private industry was a brilliant boon for Wall Street. And so they said, we'll do it for the kids too. We'll make kid prisons. That's where a lot of this came from.
Oh, wow. So when did this started to happen? I mean, the idea of like private equity getting into this business, you can see, I mean, they're getting into everything now.
Absolutely.
You go see half your doctors or your dentists at this point owned by private equity. They're cutting back and trying to streamline things. I can only imagine what they're doing in terms of warehousing kids. Like, who are the kids?
I mean, so there's a lot of different ways these kids can be put in this facility. It can be truancy. It can be smoking. It could be, a made up injury sometimes that these private companies sell parents on. So there's a couple different ways you can get put in one of these facilities as a kid. One, your parents can send you, and two, the state can send you. And so you have some going through the juvenile justice system or been involved in some way, and they say, oh, you're out of control. We're sending you one of these facilities. And the state has contracts with these facilities. One thing we've seen in Alabama, and I know you're going to have a guest on later to talk about a little bit, blood and feces smeared rooms. It's just truly horrific. And we're seeing that around the country with these facilities. There's a GAO report from 2008 documenting murders and deaths of children at these facilities. These wilderness facilities, in particular out west, where kids are died from exposure to the elements, hypothermia, broken arteries, all sorts of crazy things. And they fall in regulatory gray areas. When they do get in trouble and there's bad publicity, they just change their names because there's not a lot of right licensing requirements for these facilities from state to state.
So some of these, so if I understand it correctly, so some are contracted as like, almost like prisons, state prisons for people who haven't quite quit it, for young people who haven't quite committed a crime, but they're just too difficult to deal with in the, they're just getting warehoused, aren't they?
They're absolutely getting warehoused. They're not being educated. I mean, truly horrific. If they weren't traumatized when they went in, they certainly will be traumatized when they come out. And some of these companies sell parents on the idea that they have a child who's out of control. It's pretty incredible when you see some of these websites about the private place kids said, oh, can your kid not pay attention? Or are they disrespectful? You know, typical teenage behavior. And they convince parents that they have a psychiatric problem. Some brand themselves as psychiatric facilities. So send your kid here, we'll fix them. Parent, well-meaning parents, send their kids here, and their contact with the outside world is monitored. They're limited to, like, some of these facilities only have one parental visit a quarter. It's truly horrific conditions. And so the parents don't know. They think they did their kid a favor when in reality they're being sexually assaulted.
So let me get a sense in that scenario. So the first scenario is, this person's a ward of the state. For whatever reason, the state can't handle them. They outsource them to this sort of prison-like type of situation.
Private child prison.
the second sort of scenario is where middle-income, wealthier people, I imagine, certainly Paris Hilton, I think her family was extremely wealthy, right?
And absolutely.
And they have a kid who's maybe perceived as doing too much drugs, or having a drinking problem or socializing problem or not getting along with the parents. And this is something to instill some measure of character or discipline in them, ostensibly. They send them there, and this facility basically has this asymmetric relationship with the parents where they can say, we're the experts. This kid, trust us. Come back in 6 months and we'll take care of this type of
absolutely.
Thing.
Absolutely.
And that's basically what's happening. And then it's a black box at that point.
Anytime you have lack of regulation, money, and children, time and time again, we've seen problems. We saw that with the Boy Scouts of America. We saw that with the Archdiocese. And this is just another example of one of these black box relationships, especially now that you have private equity here, Wall Street money saying we need profits, we need profits, we need profits. So you couple that with no state regulation, coming to check on these kids, and then they have that asymmetrical relationship with the parent or the governor, whoever sent the child here. And so they get updates that, oh, everything's great. Some of these families we've talked to, they thought everything was fine and little Jimmy was doing great until they got the notice, oh, he passed away. Or we've had to take him to the hospital. He's in a coma. It's truly incredible what's happening to some of these children right here in America. I encourage your listeners to just Google the troubled teen industry and see some of the accounts of the survivors of these industries. And the manipulation, both on the marketing side and to the parents, is incredible. It's absolutely incredible.
And so there's no, I guess it's one of those things where I had never contemplated it, but it's almost impossible to imagine that there's no regulatory agency.
It's amazing. We had a senator speak.
There's like no social workers that go in and certify that.
Regulation for a lot of these companies from state to state that they have to be certified, that they can just client, and they have, industry certifications that they control. And so we had one facility that got the star of approval from this industry invented certification program right after they had killed two kids. And they still got the star of approval for being this excellent but it's a industry certification. It's not a state certification.
Right.
So as long as you send your fee in, you get the certification. Truly horrendous conditions. And because, if you do get enough heat and you get enough press on a particular facility, they just rebrand and say, oh, that was the old regime, we're the new regime. And it's the same people. It's the same people.
So give me a sense of like the different stages of cases here and how do they get pooled? I mean, how are they mass? Are these just cases that are brought on an individual basis because they have to be brought against specific companies, or explain to me the dynamic of how this works?
So right now around the country, and we've been coordinating with attorneys on an individual level, there's been certain class actions that have succeeded. Unfortunately, there's been many more that failed because you've got such various injury from child to child.
Will you just explain that in the context of a class action? There are specific requirements for you to belong into a class.
Correct.
So, and it is not a function necessarily of the malfeasance of the defendant, but rather a consistency in the injury that allows you to be in a class.
Absolutely. Across the plaintiff pool. So because the defendant hurt you differently than they hurt me, we can't be in a class together. That's why MDLs were invented, is because the injury will be different from person to person.
But the offense essentially is similar.
Absolutely.
So the difference being, I go into a facility and I am sexually abused there versus I go to a facility and maybe I am, they give me wrong drugs for my, for a supposed mental condition I have. I have a different, there's two different injuries there, but it's the same sort of level of malfeasance.
Absolutely.
in that instance, because there's two different injuries, can't have a class action suit, but we can have a mass tort because we're saying you've done bad stuff. It's impacted different people in different ways. We'll figure out how to redress those damages after the fact. Absolutely. With some form of algorithm.
Absolutely. Well, and we can bind up a lot of people's cases so they can leverage themselves together against a powerful corporate defendant, especially a Wall Street defendant who's extremely well funded versus one person who, you know, may not have enough of an injury to justify going after these cases. But when you've got 10, 15, 20 of them against the same defendant and it's corporate malfeasance or negligence or wantonness, the same behavior caused this child's rape, this child's broken bones, and this child's anxiety attacks. Those are all different injuries, so they can't be in a class together, but we can form an MDL with those kids.
How big are these entities? In other words, are these companies that have one or two facilities?
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, so there is some variety. There are some what we call mom and pop operations.
Give us a sense of like what we're talking about in terms of the scale of these defendants.
So Sequel is the one I like to talk about the most because the truly awful, some of the things that happened around the country. Sequel was named because the owner had been in the private prison industry, and the follow-up to the private prison industry was going to be these children prisons. And so the Sequel Corporation was born. And a few years ago, they tried to go public, and they self-evaluated to the SEC to be worth about $500 million.
Wow.
They were 19 states, dozens and dozens of facilities. And this was just one. They're not even the biggest player. Some of these companies are listed on the stock exchange. They're corporate overlords or hedge funds. So some of them are worth billions of dollars. It's truly incredible the size and scope of some of these facilities and their parent organizations. But you also have some religious organizations that are in this space that are under the umbrella of a national religious organization that are running these camps, and some truly horrendous abuses coming from those as well.
And so what do you need to show? Like, for instance, that first one, C-Core, is it?
Sequel.
Sequel. How many cases are there? I mean, how many kids have they housed, and how many cases are coming out of that?
So they house thousands and thousands of kids every year, and there's hundreds of cases coming out of it. Part of the problem is making sure that the child first understands that they have a case. Obviously, the parents, there's some amount of shame for some of them, that especially if they sent the child there or allowed the child to be placed there by a seemingly well-meaning therapist or something like that. So sometimes we have a strange family dynamic, but I mean, there's hundreds upon hundreds of these cases against this one particular defendant. So some of these defendants have thousands of claimants against them because of what was done. And when you get into particularly awful facilities, there could be thousands upon thousands of kids who've went through there over the years.
I mean, I imagine on top of like the idea that there's some type of redress for these injuries, I would imagine that it also would be helpful to those parents to know that they weren't sort of alone in making that kind of mistake. I mean, because we're presumably, I mean, I'm sure there are some parents who are like, I just don't want to deal with this kid. But I would imagine the vast majority of them, they're desperate. It's their last, their last sort of like step in trying to deal with a kid that seems to be out of control, and they're concerned about where the next thing happens.
Absolutely. I think so many of these parents are so well-meaning, just trying to help their child. And that's every parent's worst fear, is that something you do causes harm to your child. They're unaware. The marketing, the slick marketing and the false promises, the snake oil that they're sold, that these things can be fixed by tough love. A lot of this industry, unfortunately, the history is quite fascinating. It was started by a cult and had a cult faction in the 80s. And then this industry.
What cult started this?
So I cannot remember the name off the top of my head, but Seder was one of the first followers of that. And these organizations, kind of this tough love idea, you probably remember, really popular in the 90s. And that these raps, they call where they use the other children to attack, verbally assault each other and break them down. And Paris spoke about that yesterday during the main conference, that she still has nightmares as a older woman now from what happened to her at these facilities and the verbal and physical assaults that she endured.
Jeez. And so What if there are folks who are these cases, are your clients both students and parents?
Absolutely. And so sometimes there's different claims they can bring. We've seen claims and brought claims under Consumer Protection Acts because of the false marketing, because of the false branding. We've done medical malpractice cases because of the chemical restraints that some of these children, I mean, heavy, heavy psychotropic drugs given to every child to keep them chemically compliant. And so different claims can be brought by different people. Some of these people are older now and they're, you know, sexual assault cases. And so maybe have a longer statute of limitations depending on the state. But we hear once we kind of get into a facility, it's just account of account of account after abuse. And to your listeners, as you get these cases or take these cases, it's truly heart-wrenching because once you have one kid come forward, we see so many times others come forward.
Well, really fascinating, really disturbing. Caleb Cunningham, thank you so much for talking to us about it. Really,
thank you for having me. We appreciate you.
All right.